Controller. Today we'll be continuing with the remaining pins of the 8085 chip. Okay, so the first set of pins that we'll be covering is the status pins. Okay, so from here we can see that the status pins are 29, which is S0. Let's just keep that aside. 33, which is S1, and 34, which is IO bar M bar. Okay, so what are status pins? Status pins are used to inform the peripherals regarding the current status of the processor. And what do you mean by status? By status, it means that what machine cycle or what operation, sorry, which operation is taking place. So basically the processor uses the status pins to let the peripherals know that what type of operation is taking place, and under certain conditions some specifications regarding the internal part of the operation which is taking place. Okay, so let's see them. I'll just draw a truth table. So we have the three status pins, IO bar M bar, S1 and S0. So we'll take this as the operation. Okay. So if, we'll understand the status or the meaning from the table. So suppose this is 001. Okay. It means memory write is happening. If it is 010, memory read is happening. Right. If it is 011, then it is an opcode fetch machine cycle. We'll come to these in detail later. Okay, then now for the time being, keep it like that. 0101, it means right. If it is 110, it is IO read. And for 11, right, zero zero, because 11 is already there. For 00, it is halt operation. Okay. We can derive some patterns. Like if S1, S0 is 01, it will be a write operation. And if S1, S0 is 10, it will be a read operation. Similarly, if IO bar M bar is 0, it will be a memory operation, sorry. This opcode fetch is also happening from the memory. And if IO bar M bar is 1, then it will be a IO operation. So this is how we can identify what is happening here. And the thing is that IO bar M bar is that particular signal which acts as both as a status pin and as a control pin. right. And finally, if S1 and S0 is 0, 0, then this is IO bar M bar is a don't care condition, because anyway it is the processor is halting, it is a halt operation. So now this one, whether the concept that IO bar M bar is both a status pin and a control pin, it brings us to the next thing, next classification, which is the control pins. So the control pins are write, which is 31, read, which is 32, and again IO bar M bar, which is 34, right. So what does it mean? We have read bar, let me just change the color. We have read bar, we have write bar, and we have IO bar M bar. So if read bar is 0, it means some read operation is happening. It can be memory or it can be IO, input output device. If write bar is 0, then some write operation is happening. Again, it can be memory or it can be IO device. So this defines whether IO bar M bar is 0 or 1. It defines whether an IO operation is happening or a memory operation is happening, right. So basically the thing is that the processor generates these three signals using the control pin, and from that we have to derive certain control signals, which is in turn given to the memory devices and IO devices for reading and writing. So again, once more, we use the read bar, write bar, and IO bar M bar. So the thing is that both these read and write are active low signals, and there will never be a condition like read equal to 0 and write equal to 0. Okay, there will never be that condition. Read equal to 0 and write equal to 0. This RD bar, WR bar, that is used for a notation to just to signify that it is an it is an active low signal. Okay, so the pin signal is read and write. So now let's see how it is used. So we are implementing a logic, right? We are implementing certain logic gates to generate our control signal. These are our control signals. These three, IO M bar, RD bar, and WR bar, these are control lines. Using these control lines, we generate our control signals, and these control signals are given to the peripheral devices. For example, memory write bar, MEMR, memory read. This control signal is given to the read pin or read enable pin of the memory chip. Similarly, this is given to the write enable pin of the memory chip, and this is similarly given to the read enable pin of the IO device and write enable pin of the IO device. This is just showing the address and data bus. The significance of this part here is that these are used for we are basically using these to control whether data is being read or write from a memory or IO device. And to read and write data from anything, you need addresses and data bus. That's why this is shown here. This is just another way of implementing the same signals, right? This is the same signals using these, just a different implementation, that's all. That of IO interfacing, that is input output devices. So we have input output devices, and we have to connect them to the processor, right? So that process is called interfacing. So we can connect input output devices to the processor in two ways. The ways differ in the manner that how the processor views the I/O device. So there is the first thing is called as a memory mapped I/O, and the other is called as the I/O mapped I/O. So here what it means is that in memory mapped I/O, the processor views the I/O devices mapped in this way or connected in this way as just another memory location. Okay, that is some memory address will be issued or allotted to the I/O device. In I/O mapped I/O, the I/O device will be viewed as an I/O device itself, not as a memory location or address location. So both has its own advantages and disadvantages. So let's just go through this. Okay, so here it is treated as memory. Here it is treated as I/O device only. Okay, so if it is treated as memory, it means the address lines used will be A0 to A15. Okay, that is 16 lines are used, and the memory I/O devices can take any of these, right? That is, if the processor is able to address 2 to the power of 16 locations, the memory I/O devices can be mapped to any of these, even all. Okay, but usually it is not done all, but sometimes some of them will be used. So that is a maximum of 64K devices can be connected. Okay, maximum 64K devices. But here, if it is treated as an I/O devices, the address lines used will be A0 to A7. That means maximum 256 devices can be connected. Okay, but the prompt here, if you look at it, you will see, you will like, you may jump to the conclusion that okay, this is good because you can connect a lot of I/O devices, right? But here the problem is that the effective memory space is reduced. Right, effective memory space is reduced. Here memory space is not affected. That is, you have maximum addressing capacity. Right, here if you are connecting I/O devices as memory locations, what happens? You are eating away from the memory locations which can be connected to the memory line, right? That is, for example, if you are connecting 100 or 10 I/O devices as memory locations, what happens is that many locations will be lost from the memory space. But here, if you are connecting them as dedicated I/O devices, or I/O, if you are using I/O mapped I/O, means you can connect 256 devices. That is the maximum, because only 8 bits are there for addressing. But the thing is that this 256 is along with the 64K address space. That is, you can connect 64K memory locations and 256 devices. That is, maximum addressing capacity of the processor is exploited. Okay. The next thing is that we use memory read and memory write control signals. Okay, why is that? Because we are considering the I/O devices to be memory locations. Here I/O read and I/O write will be control signals are used. Okay, which is whatever is coming here, it is derived from the basic concept. Okay. One advantage of connecting it with memory map IO is that, like, all instructions which is used for memory can be used, right? That is, whatever memory, whatever instruction that can be used for a memory device, memory location, that can be used for an IO device here. But here, special or specific instructions are required, which is in and out. Specific instructions are required. That is sort of limiting, because this memory instructions which are capable of accessing memory, it will have a higher, better or more addressing modes and better capabilities compared to these two. It is very limiting. This is very advantageous. Okay. The other thing is that data transfer to registers, right? No data transfer to not no data transfer data to any register. Okay, here data transfer can be done to any register which a memory location can access, but here data transfer to only accumulator. Right, to only accumulator. So when you consider from the point of view of the ease of writing program, memory mapped IO is advantageous and IO map IO is not so. But when it comes to exploiting the hardware capability of the processor, IO mapped IO is better. Okay, so the last point is that here the execution speed varies, because varies between let's say 70 to 13T. We'll come to this detail later, so I'll just forget it. Let's say the execution speed varies, because for memory operation, different type of instructions take different time period to complete. But here, constant speed of execution, right? Because only two instructions are there and they have the same speed of execution. But here, because different instructions are there for memory access, the time varies. This I don't think you can say consider this as an advantage or disadvantage in any particular sense, but these two are the right, these two factors are the ones which are usually, which should be considered when a designer goes for a memory mapped IO or IO mapped IO. This is regarding the IO interfacing. Which is a ready pin. Okay. So ready pin is used to synchronize microprocessor with slower peripherals, right? Slower peripherals. Suppose the microprocessor is communicating with some device. Okay, this is a 8085 processor, and this is some peripheral. It is communicating, and the speed of execution of whatever is here, it is slower, or is speed of access is slower compared to the 8085. Then what happens is that when this is doing something and the 8085 has to wait, it gives a ready signal, right? Or it uses the ready signal. So how it is used is that when the ready signal is zero, the processor goes into something called as a wait stage, right? That is, the ready pin will be connected to the peripheral using the appropriate pin in the peripheral, and whenever the peripheral is busy doing something and it wants the processor to wait, it will make the ready as zero, and the processor will go into a wait state. Okay, it will go into a wait state and it will remain there till ready pin equal to 1, and once the ready pin is 1, the processor comes out of the ready wait state and goes on with its business. Okay, so how is it done? The ready pin is connected between the peripheral and the 8085, and whenever the peripheral is slow and it wants the processor to wait, it will put a zero or a low in the ready pin and the processor will go into a wait state. How long will it go into the wait state? Till the ready pin is changed from 0 to 1. Once the ready pin is changed from 0 to 1, the processor will snap out of the wait state and will continue with its regular functioning or whatever is required next. That is the purpose of ready pin. The pins regarding DMA, direct memory access. So which are those? A39 and 38, hold and hold acknowledge. So before that, let's just recap what direct memory access or DMA is. That is, the processor has control over the memory and obviously the bus, the address bus and data bus. Suppose an IO device wants to do some communication with the memory, or it wants to read or write something with the memory. What it does is that it uses a DMA controller, direct memory access controller, right? And how is it working? It requests, right, the DMA controller requests the processor for direct memory access, and the processor grants the direct memory access, and this IO device communicates with the memory for however time is allotted, right, or till it's done, depending on the mode. That is how it is done. And once it completes its operation, it relinquishes control of the bus, address bus and data bus, and communication between the processor and memory goes back. This is the basic concept of direct memory access, and the two types are burst mode, which is bulk transfer, and cycle stealing. Cycle stealing mode. Okay. So coming to the pins, we have hold and HLDA's hold acknowledge. Okay. So when a peripheral device wants to request DMA with the processor, what it does is that it makes hold equal to 1. That is, this request is given to hold, so this becomes 1 here. Okay, it becomes 1 here, and if the processor is willing to give the DMA, it gives an acknowledgement which is hold acknowledge equal to 1. That is, this will, the processor will make this as 1. This as 1. What happened? The processor gives up control over the buses, that is address data and control bus, right? It gives up data from the buses, and it makes those pins, those particular pins, that is the address bus, the data bus, and the control pins. These pins, they will be tri-stated. Okay, this will be tri-stated, and that is the control is now this way. Control is now this way. So once the DMA, the IO device is done transferring data, and it wants to relinquish control, what happens? It makes this BR, or which is connected to hold, into zero. Right. Once this is made zero, the processor makes this as zero, and it takes back control. Okay. That is how then hold acknowledge becomes zero when hold is equal to zero. This is requesting DMA. Okay, so this is the logical flow. The peripheral device requests for DMA by making hold as one. Again, you can see hold is input, hold acknowledges output. Hold is made one, that is DMA is requested. Then what happens? The processor makes hold acknowledge as one. At the same time, it gives up the control over the buses. How does it do that? By tri-stating the relevant pins. Okay, tri-stating pins. The pins of pins regarding the address, data, and control bus. Then when does hold acknowledge become zero? Once the DMA controller is done communicating with the memory, it makes hold equal to zero. That means it is done. Then the processor makes hold acknowledge equal to zero. At the same time, it removes the tri-state and it regains control of the buses, different buses. That is how DMA functions. And the last two pins are VCC and VSS. Basically, power supply, which is a plus 5 volt, and ground. Okay, so that is regarding the different pins of the 8085 processor. Particular lecture, and from the next lecture onwards, we will start with the concept of machine cycle, and from there we'll move on to the instruction set and addressing modes of 8085 processor. Thank you.